Our opening song will be "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name," number 229.
Power of Jesus.
The next song will be Come Thou Fount, number 334.
Thank you, praise song singers and ensemble musicians, for the beautiful musical renditions. If you look on your program in the back, their names are listed there. You will notice that they are all students. We appreciate them taking their time from their study period to practice and to perform for us. Let's give them a big hand of applause. Joyce and I want to welcome each of you to our auxiliary mission vespers. This is not just another ordinary mission vespers. The buzzword around this weekend is one homecoming. This alumni includes all eight schools. If some of you who are here for the first time, we want to give you a very special welcome. What is the medical auxiliary about? We work very closely with Dr. Hart and the School of Medicine to support our students locally and our alumni internationally. You see the map? We have 30 DMAs working in 11 countries. Timeless, I remember the only missionaries were in Guam. So we have them now in 11 countries. This morning, I think I heard Dr. Hart say that we have 60 DMAs in our schools, and we're very proud of them. Now Joyce is going to tell you about some of the auxiliaries that came before us.
We thought you would enjoy seeing some of the earliest pictures that have been taken about of the medical auxiliary. This is the auxiliary in 1947. They're making patient gowns, which they are sewing and sending overseas to, in support of our auxiliary members, our auxiliary missionaries that were then overseas. This next one is the auxiliary luncheon at the APC event at the Biltmore Hotel on March 10, 1953. It was amazing, but all the events were held at the Biltmore in Los Angeles in those days. It was before the school moved out here, of course. And then, Betty?
Now we want to show you some of our board members working very hard. We meet once a month to discuss our programs and our activities that we support our students in the form of the Little White House, scholarship funds, and our main project is to raise funds for our alumni serving overseas. We help them to buy equipment and medical supplies that are not provided by the organization. Dr. Jenny and her husband, Dr. Paul Yeo, were on furlough in February. We invited them to come to our board meeting to give us their experiences as missionaries and update their program in Zambia. And they have a little two-month-old newborn, so we gave them a little baby shower.
Wonderful to see those babies, I tell you. Amazing that they're willing to have them, even though they're overseas. This is a picture of when we had lunch with Scott and Becky Gardner, who came to Loma Linda to visit. And we love seeing our missionaries that we're supporting come, and we love to meet with them and get better acquainted. So if any of our missionaries that you know of are coming to Loma Linda, tell them to give us a call. We'll treat them to lunch, and we'll just have a wonderful time. Scott and Becky are now serving in Sierra Leone at our hospital there, and they arrived just in the middle of the Ebola crisis.
Well, I want to say that the first trip Ellen White made to Loma Linda, she said, this place looks familiar, even though she has never been here before. The reason is because she has seen it in her vision. If it were not for Ellen White's vision, there would not have been a Loma Linda University or a medical auxiliary. You and I are here today because God has chosen this very place, and through the vision of Ellen White, this medical school and all the eight schools were established. Now we are happy to welcome Dr. Ingrid Blomquist to join our Vespers tonight. She is the president of AIMS. She has a couple of awards to present. After Dr. Blomquist's presentation, our program will continue without any more announcements.
Before Dr. Blomquist speaks, I'd like to ask us to bow our heads for opening prayer. Dear gracious Lord and compassionate Savior, we come here today as your children, seeking your blessing as we remember our past and contemplate our future. We need your blessing as we attempt to offer supportive service to our students, to our alumni, and to all those who are acting as your healing hands around the world. May our hearts be touched by the stories of those who have answered your call to serve in dangerous and challenging places. Give us and them your strength to persevere. We invite your presence here today, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. AIMS is the Association of International Medical Services, also known as the Association of International Mission Services. I'm joined by two of my board members, Ed Crick and Steve Hildebrand, and we're going to be honoring the shoulders on which we stand. Let's have the first video.
After serving as a conscientious objector in World War II, this Global Service awardee attended what is now Andrews University. He completed his medical degree at Loma Linda in 1955 and began his medical practice in Cleveland, Georgia. In 1966, he accepted a call by the General Conference to serve at Benghazi Adventist Hospital in Libya. An eventful term included the opening of a new hospital, a sudden military evacuation from the country after the Six-Day War in 1967, and the miraculous survival of his daughter after an injury caused by old World War II munitions. Returning to the U.S. in 1969, our awardee settled in Munising, Michigan, where he practiced for more than 40 years. He served on numerous mission trips to countries including the Democratic Republic of Congo, Nepal, India, Indonesia, the Philippines, Peru, and the Dominican Republic. In Cambodia, he was confronted by the commandos on the way to a clinic in a remote border village near the killing fields. For 22 consecutive years, he was a relief physician at the Adventist Clinic in Guam. During trips to Kenya, he introduced his three granddaughters to mission work. Our awardee views his life as but a modest return on the investment made in him by others. He now spends his time in Michigan and Oregon. His late wife, Alice, passed away in 2013. He has four children, three of whom are doctors or nurses today. Please join me in recognizing this Loma Linda University School of Medicine graduate from the class of 1955 and a recipient of the 2017 AIMS Global Service Award, Dr. Donald C. Farbach. Born in Malaysia, this Global Service awardee narrowly escaped a Japanese bombing as he and his missionary parents fled to the United States at the beginning of World War II. Returning to Singapore, he graduated from Far Eastern Academy before completing pre-medical studies at what is now Andrews University. At medical school in Loma Linda, our awardee became a deferred mission appointee. After graduating in 1963, he was called to serve in Japan. Relocating to the island nation, he spent a year of intense study and prayer before passing the medical exam in Japanese. Serving at Tokyo Adventist Hospital, he shared the story of his family's escape from Japanese bombs and was able to promote an attitude of forgiveness. He took a residency in obstetrics and gynecology in Loma Linda and returned to Tokyo to help upgrade the obstetrics department. His work was instrumental in instituting epidural anesthesia for labor and delivery. He also joined trips to fishing villages where medical staff held clinics. Eventually returning to the United States, our awardee practiced for a number of years in North Carolina. He occasionally returned to Tokyo to assist the obstetrics department and participated in mission trips to Guam SDA Clinic. In 1990, he began practicing emergency medicine in Florida, which he did until retiring in 2012. He and his wife, Yvonne, live in Apopka, Florida. They have 4 children and 10 grandchildren. Please join me in welcoming from the Loma Linda University School of Medicine class of 1963, our 2017 Ames Global Service awardee, Dr. John L. Nernes.
The mission of the Loma Linda University Medical Auxiliary is to demonstrate God's love through benevolence and shared service. One of the priorities of the auxiliary is to promote the mission work of its alumni. We always feel so blessed and are amazed each year of the financial gifts we receive from you. This is the only way that requests for equipment, building improvements, and students' mission electives become realities. Thank you. 4 years ago, Merle Hildebrand, mission chair for several years, started our Christmas Mission Box project. The goal? A way to say to our mission families, we remember you, we appreciate you and what you do, and we want you to have a few tangible items to remind you of home. Maggie and Adrian Cotton, with their 3 boys, continued the program last year. This year, I wanted to involve grandchildren, including giving my own grandchildren an opportunity to work and give outside their neighborhood. Other auxiliary grandmas wanted to be a part of this also. Our project was entitled Boxes for Whitney. We wanted to honor the talented and beautiful granddaughter of Betty Wong, Whitney Watson, who passed away a little over a year ago. Each year, we refine our list of contents for the Christmas box, having heard from alumni missionaries of things they needed, wanted, or missed. This year, we enlisted the help of a dozen grandchildren of auxiliary members ages 2 to 12 to purchase supplies. So here we have 3 of Rhonda Hoig's grandchildren. We had several families that had children, so they decided to find Band-Aids that would match the age of the children. So they were all kinds, and it was really fun. This is Braden and Andrew Fisk, and they were picking out books for the missionary children. These happen to be my grandchildren, and they know that macaroni and cheese is always a favorite, and Anne's is supposed to be a healthy kind, so we sent some macaroni and cheese. Oh, here's Crystal Light, Max's favorite, and hot chocolate. So here we have 4 more. We have June and Levi Hadley and Amelie and Mila Zalzman. And we have all the items lined up in rows because they're getting ready to pack the boxes. Here's Phil Hoxie and some of the same children. You can see other kinds of supplies. And this is a completed box. You can see that Let's see. The children had a great time packing the boxes with all kinds of items, including peanut butter, chocolate chips, brownie mix, lip gloss, duct tape, flashlights, and many other items. These had to be squeezed into each box in a precise order to make it all fit. This was part of their challenge. The children took their job very seriously. When placing a can of fry check in the box, one child commented that he was a vegetarian and he wondered if the missionaries were. So we hope that they enjoyed their fry check. One of our mission families, Seth and Yamina Lukens, have 3 children. We had so many toys and treasures for their daughter and 2 sons, we ended up sending 2 boxes to Botswana. Funding for the Mission Box Project is part of the annual Auxiliary Christmas Boutique. Each year, our guests have the opportunity to purchase individual Christmas boxes and or buy the postage for one of these boxes. They included our personal messages from these supporters. Our 10 boxes this year went to Zambia, Liberia, Botswana, Haiti, Honduras, Nepal, and Sierra Leone. These Christmas mission boxes were a gift of love from our grandchildren and the auxiliary to our mission families, to Betty, and to the memory of her granddaughter.
Thank you, Jolene. It's a busy weekend. Seems like we're moving from one program to another, but thank you all for being here. We want to share a few stories from some of those who have gone and have come back and some of those who are going. As you know, this is the proud moment for Loma Linda when our graduates can literally scatter all over the world. And the footprint is broadening every year as they go to more and more different places. We're going to share some of the new places in a minute as well that our graduates are looking at. But I want to start first with one, a family that just left this week. I tried to get him down. He says, sorry, our tickets are bought. We're on our way to Nepal. Many of you know Jonathan Thorpe, a son of Brad and Candace Thorpe, who ran the Hope Channel for many years. And Jonathan married Allie Westermeyer, a Westermeyer family that's also a long mission family. And they recorded a video for us just as they were getting ready to go to the airport from Portland to Nepal.
Good afternoon and happy Sabbath. Thank you so much, Dr. Hart, for the invitation to send a short greeting to the Vespers program this afternoon. We are so excited to leave in a few days' time to move to Nepal to work at Shear Memorial Hospital. Allie, myself, and baby James, our two-month-old baby boy, will be moving in to work with the international team at the hospital. Dr. and Mrs. Stan and Raylene Sturgis started Shear Memorial Hospital back in the 1950s. They were the first Seventh-day Adventist missionaries to work in the country of Nepal. Shortly after moving, they were able to secure visas and an invitation from the king to work in the town of Banapa, located about 15 miles east of Kathmandu. They started working in homes in the area, a one-room clinic, and then finally, as their ministry began to grow, they shared their story with many friends and alumni back at home. And the Shear family found out about the opportunity to build a hospital, and in memorial of their parents, they built a 20-bed hospital for Dr. and Mrs. Sturgis to use as their primary point of ministry in the community. Nepal is primarily a Hindu country. And even today, only 1.4% of the country is Christians. Christianity has grown significantly over the last number of years, from 0 to 375,000. In fact, it's the fastest growing Christian nation by some reports globally. The Adventist Church has also been growing since the 1980s when it was officially recognized in the country. But when they started off, they had no official church structure. And as I mentioned, they were the only Adventists in the entire country. And it was the ministry they were doing, meeting people where they were at, meeting their needs, healing them by the grace of God, and carrying them. And that's what we're looking forward to continuing in just a few days when we move to work at the hospital. Last year we had the opportunity to visit the hospital and to see the opportunities there. We're really excited to work as a physician and nurse practitioner team. Allie will be working primarily as a nurse practitioner in women's health, and I'll be taking roles of administrative roles and also primary care from the ambulatory to the intensive care settings. We're looking forward to expanding our clinical practice and hopefully impacting many people's lives as they come through. The hospital has grown from 20 beds to a full service 150-bed facility with many different service lines, including general surgery, urology, orthopedic surgery, internal medicine, pediatrics, and psychiatry, to name a few. Some of you may be asking, why are you moving to Nepal? Why are you moving to work internationally? Well, we're really excited to have found the Shear Memorial Hospital as our location of service as deferred mission appointees. We are grateful for the mentorship of Dr. Hart and others as we went through and looked at different options, including locations in Peru and Central and Southern Africa. And it was really the burden of working in the area of the world where Christianity is still of very small proportions. And so we're looking forward to continuing on our Christian responsibility. As we think back to Matthew chapter 28, when Jesus gave the instruction to go to all the world, to all the nations, we're looking forward to continue as he's directed us. We'd like to invite you to follow along, to follow our story as we work and minister in the community, to follow our blog, ajourneytowardhome.wixsit.com/journey. That's ajourneytowardhome.wixsit.com/journey. I'd like to invite you to share our stories with those you come in contact. It's not because we want to be lifted up on a pedestal or anything. It's because we want the greater awareness to the needs, the medical needs, the social needs, the physical needs, the spiritual needs of the people of Nepal. And that's one way you can partner with us in helping to share our story. We'd invite you to pray for us. We're going to a country where sharing the gospel is still technically not permitted. And so we're looking to find creative ways to minister to people, but also to connect them to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we wish we could be with you this afternoon to talk with you in person, but we're so glad that we could send these greetings. We look forward to inviting any medical student, nursing students also, to come from Loma Linda to work with us and follow along at Shear Memorial for a short rotation. God bless. Have a wonderful Sabbath afternoon. Thank you so much.
Jonathan has just finished his internal medicine residency and was chief medical resident at one of the Johns Hopkins hospitals back in Baltimore. And Allie did her nurse practitioner back there as well. So they're on their way out there. Some of you know the incredible history of this hospital. This is where Stanley Sturgis went out, class of 1955 from Loma Linda. I can remember as a young man when Stanley was elected one of the 10 most outstanding young men in America. Man, that's okay. That's Loma Linda at its best. So thank you, and we will keep Jonathan and Allie in our prayers. We next want to shift to a different part of the world, the country of Haiti. And I can remember about 10 years ago now when a group of young medical students came into my office and spun their dream. Now, I get used to young people having dreams, and I usually humor them and encourage them, but don't expect it all to happen. This group of students says, our goal is to take on a mission hospital, and we want to raise $100,000 by the time we graduate. Well, knowing a little bit about their debt burden and a few other things, I says, can this really happen? And David Puda was one of those. David, tell us how that came about and where that dream got started.
Yeah, so a lot of us, after our first year of medical school, went out to various mission hospitals and shadowed, participated, and we came back really excited. We got together as a class and we said, what can we do as a class together? And we decided to adopt a hospital in Haiti. And so we met with Dr. Hart, and we were just really excited. We went over there after our second year of medical school. We went back our third year, and after the earthquake, a lot of our classmates were really galvanized and went back, and we were one of the only standing hospitals left. So we were very busy and excited to help.
As I recall, by the long in your junior year, up to maybe $60,000 or $70,000, we weren't sure they were going to make the 100 until January 12, 2010 happened, the earthquake in Haiti. And we had trouble keeping the entire senior class here at campus to finish their school year because they all wanted to go to Haiti down to help. But after that, the money came in, and by the time you graduated, you had raised?
It was, I think, $110,000 or $120,000.
Yeah, $119,000 that had come in for Haiti by the time you graduated. What was so neat on this story then is that one of their own, actually two of their own, after they finished their residency, had now started working in Haiti. So we're now going to watch a video from Alex Kotsoumpas, who finished his surgery residency here, and then has been down in Haiti for about 6 months now, a year and a half now.
Yeah, Alex and Joe.
Yeah, and Joseph Kim has gone down as well, and Melissa Kim, the class behind them, are now working down in Haiti. We are hoping to make Haiti another field station. You heard this morning, for those at church, that we've made Malamulo into a field station where we literally kind of beef up the training opportunities, the housing opportunities, the security issues, and so on, so we can have a number of students go there and residents go there. And our goal is to do that same thing with Haiti. So we have one place in the Americas that we can do that with. And then ultimately, we want to also do it in Nepal that you've just seen at Shear Memorial Hospital. So let's watch this video from Alex Kotsoumpas in Haiti.
Haiti, the land of many mountains, a name befitting the realities of life in this country. The struggle to survive is a constant cycle. As one mountain is summited, another mountain looms ahead. At Hospital Adventista Haiti, we have embraced this reality, and we strive ahead, one mountain at a time. For we know that we are not alone on this journey. Our institution serves a city of approximately 600,000 and borders the greater Port-au-Prince region of approximately 3 million people, a large majority of these people living below the poverty line. Through staff training and continuing medical education, a new emphasis on quality of care has been implemented at our institution. The struggle between life and death is a harsh reality, but despite the challenges, we see miracles every day. We're striving to improve all areas of our hospital for the well-being of our patients, so that at the end of the day, we can continue to see these smiling faces. We continue to climb. One mountain at a time. We continue to preserve life. One patient at a time. Through generous donations, we have been able to renovate our previously dilapidated clinical laboratory and are on our way to become a reference laboratory for the greater Port-au-Prince region. Our newly renovated emergency room was opened in October of 2016, also as a result of generous donations. This emergency room has already provided life-saving care to countless men, women, and children, both Haitian and expatriate alike. Thank you. So we continue on the journey, as we have felt the support and prayers of many. This tremendous support made it possible to have completed the renovations of our operating rooms in 2015. And we look ahead for what is to come. We don't know exactly what lies beyond the next mountain, yet we push forward. Because even just one smile is worth saving.
Amazing for me to watch that and to see the changes that have taken place in that hospital over the last few years. I need to tell a little joke. How many of you caught the picture of the C-arm in there, the special x-ray we have? When we had the dedication of the new ORs down there, I was down there, this is about a year ago, and the Prime Minister's wife came to take part in the opening ceremony, so I was walking her through and knew that she wouldn't quite understand that C-arm, so I was patiently explaining what a C-arm x-ray was all about. She listened to me out and then said, "Thank you, yeah, I understand, I'm a radiologist." In 1909, the Loma Linda University School of Medicine began. And for many years, we were the only school of medicine in the church. About 40 years ago, the Universidad de Montemorelos opened and started training physicians. About 10, 15 years after that, the River Plate University in Argentina opened. And then for a number of years, there were no other ones. But in the last 5 years, we've had three other medical schools start. Babcock University in Nigeria, Universidad Peruana Union, just outside of Lima, Peru, and Adventist University of the Philippines, just outside of Manila. So there's now 6 medical schools in the Adventist Church, and we're just on the verge of starting the 7th medical school at Adventist University of Central Africa in Kigali, Rwanda. And we're delighted to have a group here to talk with us about that. Come on forward. Dan Jung, most of you know, is our vice president for graduate medical education here at Loma Linda. And you have a family with us. Why don't you introduce them?
We have here the family, the Huang family, and this is Nzuni Huang, and we are going to talk to you a little bit about this new medical school that that the church is starting in Rwanda. It's at the Adventist University of Central Africa. The three recent schools have all been interesting to start. We have had a role in helping each of them to a greater or lesser extent. The one that has gone the smoothest is in Peru, because they had a full university and a wonderful Seventh-day Adventist teaching hospital on opposite sides of Lima, only an hour away, that they could both synergistically work together. The schools in Nigeria at Babcock University and in the Philippines, at Adventist University of the Philippines, both had strong universities, but were not allowed to use the Adventist hospitals as their teaching hospitals due to government regulations. This was a problem because then they had to try and find a clinical site for their students to work. The challenge with the Adventist University of Central Africa is that the university is there but has had no science or health education at the university since it was reconstituted and has no clinical facilities. So this is a special challenge that we are trying to help meet with folks like the Huangs. So this is the country of Rwanda that most of you are familiar with from the news. I wanted to teach you all to name the different provinces in Rwanda. They are the northern province, the southern province, the eastern province, the western province, and Kigali. So you have your free geographical education here. The country of Rwanda has about 12 million people, just a little under 12 million people, about the same population as the state of Ohio. The state of Ohio in 2012 had 850 cardiologists practicing in Ohio. In the country of Rwanda, in 2012, there were 700 physicians of all sorts for the same population. So, and looking at that, the government of Rwanda asked the Seventh-day Adventist Church, you have a university, we would like you to start a medical school. Please start a medical school, and we will give you a teaching hospital. So just a few sites of the lovely campus in Kigali. This is the new Seventh-day Adventist University there that has just been rebuilt after the troubles they had in the 90s. That's the administration building. They have a wonderful walkway around for good health. This is their new engineering building in downtown Kigali, so brand 2 years old now, and very well designed, very nice. This is the planned government teaching hospital in the northern province. That is one of the places the government says, if you want this as your teaching hospital, please take it. And here's the graduation service. The first students will be arriving in 2018, and we will be graduating them in 2024. But you need a lot of stuff before you get to a graduation ceremony like this. You obviously need facilities, and those are being built. You need faculty, basic science faculty and clinical faculty. And of course, you need a curriculum. In order to get a clinical faculty there with very few Seventh-day Adventist physicians, this is a challenge for us that we're hoping to meet. And one of the people who is meeting that challenge is Dr. Nzuni Huang, who's an internist. He is finishing one career here in the United States, and their family is moving out when? To Kigali.
We're leaving on Monday. And so we were actually supposed to leave 2 weeks ago, but Dr. Hart asked us to come here to the Mission Vespers and receive your blessing and prayers. And so we certainly couldn't refuse that. And so we gladly accepted the invitation. My family and I, this is my wife Nancy, this is Caleb, Mary, and Martha, who all hate to see themselves on camera. And so we're heading out to work on building, hopefully, what will be one day an Adventist health system in Rwanda. Right now, there is one official conference or union Adventist clinic there run by Tommy Wusang, who's been there for 7 years. He's an Indonesian cardiologist who's been practicing there in general medicine for that period of time. And what he said there is that the practice that he has started there has gained notoriety and respect, and he feels the time is really good to come and build on that work and to try to expand. So we're going to go out there and work with the division and the union and try to build what will eventually be a multi-specialty clinic that will not only help serve as a foundation for hopefully an Adventist health system to grow there, but also to help facilitate recruitment of clinical staff that can work with the medical students that will be matriculating and hopefully graduating in 2024. And so the clock hasn't started yet because the first students have not arrived yet, but it will be ticking shortly thereafter. So we certainly are looking forward to the challenge, but most of all, we're looking forward to see how the Lord will guide and bless us. And we pray for the blessings of many of you to come and help us, as well as those whom you may know. And so the clinicians there have made a point of specifically stating that they would love to see pediatricians there. And so if you may be a pediatrician or may know a pediatrician, as well as many specialties. We pray that others will come and that we can work together to not only start an Adventist health system just in Rwanda, but really for the entire region to help have places for the graduates of the division's medical school to go to and to continue to serve the people there with the Adventist health message.
Zun is a graduate of the class of 1995 here at Loma Linda. And I remember when he first walked into my office about a year and a half ago, I think now, he says, I'm changing careers. I've wrapped up my first career. I'm ready to go abroad almost anywhere in the world except Africa. So Zun and Nancy are now on their way to Kigali, Rwanda. And we'd like to pause now and have a special prayer dedication for them and for Jonathan and Allie Thorpe, who have just left a couple days ago to go serve abroad. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, what a privilege it is as once again Loma Linda sends out its best to serve the world. Be with the Wongs, with the three children, with Jonathan and Allie and their son. Bless them as they go. Keep them safe, Father. Give them courage. Give them bravery. Give them flexibility. All the skills that will be needed as they establish their home in a new country. We thank you for their commitment, for their dedication. May we as a university family support them, recognize the contribution they're making, and make this possible. We pray in your name. Amen. Thank you. One of the places you've heard us talk a lot about over the years is Malamulo, and we're delighted to have Jamie Krauts with us. Jamie has been serving at Malamulo for a number of years now, has just come back, and we'll be starting to work here at Loma Linda, down at our SAC clinic primarily. One of our long-term goals, frankly, is to get people like Jamie, and we have others, some of you met Jason and Blynn Lohr last night. There's nothing better than having people that have worked abroad come back and join our faculty, because they bring a world perspective, and mentoring students is very powerful. So Jamie, share with us a little bit some of your experiences at Malamulo, and how's it going?
Gladly, thank you, Dr. Hart. It's my privilege to say a few words about Malamulo Hospital. Just out of curiosity, Malamulo has been around for a long time. How many have visited Malamulo Hospital in Malawi? Well, that's good to see those hands. That's quite a few. So most of you probably know Malamulo started before Loma Linda, 1902. It's had a rich history and tradition in Malawi. It also has had a few difficult times as well, as many of you know. I'd like to tell you briefly that we're on the upswing. It was actually my privilege in 2008, even though I probably shouldn't have been there, to go with Dr. Hart to the board meeting for Malamulo Hospital with Elisa Brown. Blethen now, where really the hospital was in debt, had $500,000 in debt. They weren't paying their taxes. They'd really gotten into trouble. And really that board meeting, I believe, was the inflection point where the downward trend of the era started to go into an upward trend. And I remember even from then, Dr. Hart saying to Elisa, I was just a fly on the wall. But Elisa, it's going to be 5 years until we see this hospital pick up. We are now 9 years past that point, and I'm happy to say the hospital is picking up. In the last 2 years, our inpatient census actually doubled, and our pediatric census tripled, almost quadrupled. And I know Dr. Hart, I know he doesn't love to hear a lot of numbers. He asked for stories, so I'll tell you a couple. There's a lot I could say. We've started a training program in surgery. We have an obstetrician. But I'm going to tell you a couple stories about kids, because everybody loves kids. The first one is a difficult story from a mission hospital. As anybody who's visited a mission hospital knows, mission hospitals hang together by the grace of God and by the commitment of those He moves. Malamulo is no different. And sometimes the bad stories move us more than the good stories. This bad story, I don't even know the name of the child, unfortunately, but in December, just at the beginning of malaria season, the child was sick, and their parents had brought them to the hospital, actually to the clinic, to be taken care of. The child was appropriately triaged, even though there was a long line, and they sent them directly to the hospital. They said, "You're too sick to be seen as an outpatient. You need to go to the inpatient services." There was a long line for the inpatient services, too, unfortunately. They couldn't be attended to right away, so in good faith, even though it wasn't the right procedure, they were directed to the lab so they could get their labs done and get their treatment started. This time of year, malaria is the major problem in Malawi, and so it's important to have a rapid diagnosis and treatment. So the child was sent to the lab. Now, at Malamulo Hospital, we don't make patients pay to begin with if they're inpatients, but if they're an outpatient, they have to pay. Unfortunately, it was not well communicated that this child was an inpatient that had not been admitted yet, just coming to get the labs done first. So at the lab, they told them how much the charges would be for the three tests that we normally do. The charges came to about $3, And the family said, unfortunately, $3 is more than we can afford. Mom took the baby home. I was very sad to hear 3 days later, she brought the child back just before the child died. It's stories like this that make you think, what are we doing as a mission hospital and what can we do differently? I was the medical director at the time, and beyond just what we could do, I kind of felt a little responsibility. This was, in a sense, my hospital, my staff, my community, my patients. And so we started thinking about stories like this, where such a little makes such a big difference. And we started talking to a few friends and praying about what we could do. And we kind of came up with an idea that maybe we could try to subsidize or even clear the cost for children. We were praying about it as a hospital. I was praying about it as the medical director. And it was coming time. It had been about 10 months, and malaria season was coming around again. I remember one Sabbath morning, I was praying about whether or not we should try to fundraise to take care of the kids. And that Sabbath morning, I checked my email, and I had an email from a Loma Linda alumni who had visited previously and said she would like to contribute $15,000 to take care of kids. I said, okay, God, well, I guess that's the answer. Unfortunately, 11 months previously, I thought $15,000 was enough, but my math was wrong, and it ended up being more like $115,000, but anyway, we worked through it. We prayed about it, and through the generous support of Loma Linda alumni, as well as some others, I'm happy to say in 2016, for the first year, we offered completely free care to the children in Malamulo catchment area. It almost quadrupled our census. It did reduce the number of deaths. I'd like to tell you briefly, one of those was a five-year-old child, came in with severe malaria, was comatose with cerebral malaria. We see this commonly. She was not responding for 2 days in a coma, at which point we start to be very concerned for the overall well-being of the child. Actually, she was so sick that night she stopped breathing. And it's not common that we do codes for children who stop breathing. Actually, it's very, very uncommon. But we had a team from Loma Linda who had come and taught our staff how to do PALS, pediatric acute life support. And one of our very astute clinical officers had noticed, he just happened to be around, the child had stopped breathing, he started doing chest compressions, they got a bag mask, they started doing artificial respiration for the child, and the child revived. The child did so good, actually, that 3 days later, the child went home with its mom. May not seem that amazing to a developed context, but for those of you who've been to a place like Malamulo in the condition that Malamulo has been in, it's a miracle. And it's a miracle that doesn't happen alone. It's a miracle that happens with the support of Loma Linda. It's a miracle that happens with the support of the auxiliary, the hospital, the staff, the alumni. And so the last thing I'd like to say this morning is a big thank you. Thank you to the auxiliary and for those care boxes. We love them. Thank you to the alumni who come and visit. Thank you to the alumni who go and serve long term. Thank you to Dr. Hart. Because I don't know how much this group knows, but Dr. Hart has done more for us as students, as residents, as missionaries than we could really say. And thank you from the bottom of our hearts. May God be praised for his work all around the world.
Thank you, David. Good to have Jamie and Shalina and Jedediah and Abigail and Caleb all back with us here at Loma Linda. One of the fun things here is to not only watch those who are willing to go out where we have institutions, but the amount of creative energy that goes into our students that want to go where there is nothing. And over the last few months, let me just share a few of the places that they're looking at. James Appel, many of you know, is now building a new hospital in a town called Abugadum in eastern Chad. This is clear out up against the Sudan border, largely Muslim territory. It's where the Darfur refugees from Sudan come across. And James and Sarah out there developing this brand new hospital in Abugadum, Chad. I had another couple come in to see me just a few weeks ago, both second year dental students, Jonathan Min and Anna Lee. And they quietly told their story. Korean-American students here studying dentistry, but we want to go serve, Dr. Hart, but we have a plan. we're not sure you can support our plan. I said, well, what is it? We have a burden to start a dental clinic in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, where this church basically has very little activity. And so they are already setting plans for Phnom Penh, Cambodia, to together go out and start a dental clinic there when they graduate from dentistry. A couple months ago, I was in Romania, Bucharest, Romania, where the church members in Romania have a number of wealthy developers have a burden to start a cancer hospital in Romania, a rapidly developing country in Eastern Europe that they think has great potential. And just about a month ago now, I was in Bangladesh, a country of 170 million people with about 30,000 Adventists. This is the most densely populated country in the world. This is a size of the state of North Carolina with 170 million people crammed into it. They have just started a little school of nursing at our little seminary and college there and want to develop that on into eventually a clinic and a hospital in the country of Bangladesh. One other place that's new, and I'm going to invite my colleagues to come forward, is in the country of Congo. We used to call it Zaire, and then before that we called it Belgian Congo, and we went through a number of names. A country that's been known for instability, political instability, and a lot of tribal conflict for years. Eddie and Carolina Perry are with me. Eddie graduated in 2012, and Carolina in 2014. Eddie's done now with his family practice residency. Carolina's in her final year, and they have a burden to go to Kisangani, Congo. I don't know how many of you know all your Congolese names. That's the old Stanleyville. But this is up on the headwaters of the Congo River, up in northeastern Congo, one of the roughest places, frankly, left in Africa. And Eddie and Carolina said, that's our spot. We've purchased land already. Eddie goes on eBay to buy medical equipment and gets a good deal. So tell us, why in the world are you guys going to Kisangani?
Well, it was actually during my first year of medical school I had the opportunity to serve in Chad with James Appel, who some of you may be familiar with. And he had just returned from a trip to the Congo and started telling me about the huge needs in the Congo and how unreached it was. And it really, God laid a burden on my heart for the Congo, and it wasn't until my fourth year of medical school that I had the opportunity to go and serve at one of our old institutions in Songa, in the southern part of the Congo. And also during that trip, I went up to Kisangani in the north, working with an organization called Congo Frontline Missions, which had been going for a number of years. And they had been using local church lay members to go out into the bush and start churches out in the area. And so as the years have gone on, we are now working on a partnership with them and Adventist Health International and the church there to actually start up a clinic in Kisangani, but not just to focus on the medical work, but to really use, I think in a unique way, medicine as the right hand of the gospel. So we'll have that integrated into not only our inpatient, where we have the doctors see the patients every day, but also we'll have health education classes for the patients, as well as Bible studies that are integrated for patients and families, as well as outreach into the local area. So that's kind of the brief story of how we kind of got going in this direction.
And every time I see Carolina, my question is the same. Are you sure?
I'm sure. I'm learning that whenever God calls you to do something, you just go. And even if it's going to be maybe not easy, it's going to be okay.
So Eddie, you've learned to fly. You've got an airplane. You've bought a boat, an outboard motor and so on a boat to travel the Congo River. You've got land. You're buying medical equipment. What else are you doing to get ready to go?
Well, we're working on a lot of the logistics. As you can imagine, there's a lot involved in it. And so, the government paperwork and the registration and whatnot, so we're working on doing that. And then language study for Caroline and I, so that we can speak not only the French, which is one of the official languages, but one of the local dialects, Lingala, which is spoken throughout the country, so that we can communicate with more of the villagers than we could otherwise. But things have been coming along.
And you're planning to travel out there again in October?
Yeah, we're going to spend a couple months in October working on some of the land development, getting things ready to go on that side, as well as working through some of our government paperwork and language study as well.
And Eddie's been working extra shifts, trying to get some debt paid down, trying to get some momentum to go, building up a little pot of money in AHI to be able to fund the activities out there. This is a tremendously committed couple, folk, that are going out to the edge of the world to start something new in an area that desperately needed. As I said, this has been a hotbed of various conflicts in northeastern Congo for decades. And so we greatly admire what Ed and Carolina are taking on. Any final comments you want to share with this group?
No, it's just amazing how God can, you know, take something as a, you know, first-year medical student, and now, you know, he's been leading it and with this thing and opening doors. And now the secret's out with Dr. Hart. I guess he kind of humored me for a couple of years and took me a while to, you know, convince him that it was serious. But now it's just exciting to see how God is leading. And we're just looking forward to serving the Congo and really work on sharing the gospel in this very unreached area of Africa.
Keep them in your prayers, folks. Brave couple. One of the other fun things that's been happening over the last decade, actually started with the class of 2010 in Haiti, is nearly every one of our medical school classes have come and said, we want to take on a mission hospital as our class project. And so they've taken the hospitals in Haiti, from Belize, from Guyana, from Honduras, and so on. And Tyler Pender is here from the class of 2017.
Yes, sir.
You do hope to graduate in a few months?
I sure hope so.
And their class, 2017, has taken on a project in Sierra Leone. Tell us about that.
It's actually the one in Chilala in Zambia.
That's right. You guys have got that one.
Yes. So earlier in our first year, we wanted to pick a project that was sustainable and had a real focus on education. And we talked to AHI. They had a lot of great projects, but our class really bonded with the staff in the Chilala project in Lusaka, Zambia, due to its unique model of having an urban multi-specialty center that could generate a revenue stream to fund outer clinics. So we decided before we could go and ask others for money, we're like, how invested is our class in this project? So we ran a little fundraiser just targeting our class. These are students living on loans and limited income, and said, every one of us, let's give $10. So we set a goal of $2,000, and our class responded in an amazing way. We soared up to over 2,800, and we said, okay, we're invested ourselves. After that, we took advantage of some of the amazingly talented musicians led by Jonathan Harper. We had a series of concerts attended by several hundred people. We raised an additional $11,000. God is really working in amazing ways. Earlier this afternoon, Ames gave us another $10,000, and now we're in the final push of our fundraising drive. And for us, the power of doing a class mission project goes far beyond the monetary amounts. To us, this is what Loma Linda is all about, bringing people from different backgrounds, from different faith traditions, and showing what we can do when we unite behind a shared vision, both now and also in the future. And to me, that's what's been most meaningful leading the project, is people who had never thought about missions coming up and saying, hey, this is what I'm doing for our project. And that's been tremendously rewarding.
Now, you've experienced Africa already, Tyler, as I recall.
Yes, sir.
Where?
Yeah. So I spent a year in Gimbi, in the western highlands of Ethiopia, back when I was in college.
Thank you very much. This is an example of many medical school classes and what they're committed to doing. Finally this afternoon, we want to take you to one of the toughest places in the world over the past few years, and that's Liberia and Sierra Leone and the Ebola outbreak. We've had graduates in the middle of this and have experienced tremendous challenges in doing that. The graduating class that just finished had asked Jillian Seaton, Dr. Jillian Seaton, one of our young surgeons, to come and be their graduation speaker last May. And so we thought you would enjoy seeing Jillian's commencement address to the graduating class about her experiences in Liberia.
Thank you, Dr. Hart, faculty and staff, and especially the class of 2016 for inviting me to join with you today. It seems like just yesterday I sat in your seat, terribly grateful that medical school was finally over, that we completed every medical test known to mankind, and that we no longer had to wear those short white coats and follow like ducks in a row behind an attending. But I was also scared silly about facing residency. What would it be like? Would I fail? I am happy to tell you that there are many good moments ahead. It is slightly easier than medical school because you are following now a specific area that is of great interest to you. You'll find great satisfaction in working with your patients. You'll make great friends among residents and the faculty, wherever you are located. And that is a momentous thing to celebrate today, both the closing of this chapter and the opening of the next one. This is your moment. You are now doctor. This responsibility you have accepted is an awesome one. If you don't know that already, you will. This job takes over your life because you care about your patients and your colleagues. You care about the quality of care that you provide. You care what happens to these people who are virtually strangers, but the second they put their life in your hands, they become yours. You can never leave it behind, even on vacation, because you have accepted the trust and responsibility. You will face long hours, missed dinners, necessary and ridiculous paperwork, frustrated patients and mystery cases. You will second guess your judgment and treatment decisions. You will ask your family to wait more often than they deserve, and even sadly, probably, sacrifice your health more often than you should to get through the day. Why do we do it? Certainly not for glory or for money. No, those goals lose their motivation the first time you failed a test. Why are you sitting here today? What made you go through the torture of your medical education? The threat to your person, your capabilities, your well-being, your sense of peace, your free time? What kept you from nodding off during those daily 8-hour internal medicine rounds? What gave you the energy to answer the same interview question 20 times over with the same appearance of enthusiasm? Each of you might have a different answer. Whatever your motivation, hold that close in the days ahead. Although you have many great things to look forward to during your residency and your career, there are also times of trouble coming. Why do I do it? I'm sure if we had plenty of time, we could unearth many flattering and unflattering reasons. But I do know that without a doubt, God has designed me to be a missionary and a surgeon. That does make a lot of the job easier to know that I'm in the right place. All the personal and environmental circumstances don't change that motivation. I want to help people, and I can, so I will. Mr. Kamara said when he spoke about his unpaid work as an untrained ambulance driver during Ebola, when he was interviewed by the New York Times in August of 2014, I did it because it needed to be done. 5 months after I arrived in Liberia, Thomas Scotland was assigned to me for his intern surgical rotation. He impressed me as dedicated, compassionate, and eager to learn. In fact, he was eager to teach me because I was still learning quite a bit about OB and internal medicine and pediatrics and all those other things you can't possibly learn during a surgical rotation. He was with us less than 4 weeks before Monrovia was swept under the tidal wave of Ebola, killing thousands, including long experience attending physicians, nurses, nurse aides, cleaners, and hospital administrators. At that point, 90% of the hospitals in Monrovia were closed. And then during a 9-hour meeting at the Ministry of Health, a desperate cry went out for volunteers to work in a newly established Ebola treatment unit run by a team from Uganda with some Ebola treatment experience. Thomas called me to explain one night that he wouldn't be coming back into work. He was one of the four to volunteer to work in this psychologically and physically difficult ETU setting. Let me put this in perspective for you. At the time, there were only 120 treatment beds for Ebola patients in the city. There were probably hundreds, maybe even thousands of cases in the city at that point. They were already overwhelming the few beds. They were lined up on the street outside, some alive, some dead. many in far advanced stages of Ebola. The MSF ETU was not yet open. Nobody was quite ready or prepared to handle this tidal wave. And for Thomas himself, there were no beds, no evacuation options, and no rescue for healthcare workers in West Africa. He had a young wife at home. He put everything on the line. Dr. Scotland would come in to check in with me on his day off, explaining the safety and treatment protocols to reassure me that he was doing everything possible for his personal safety. He would also tell me what Ebola patients looked like, what the most common symptoms were, what the progression of the disease looked like, what they thought was happening, because of course we don't have very good laboratories and no imaging and no way to really tell what was happening on the inside except for they looked sick. In fact, I called him one afternoon, desperate to get a clearly symptomatic Ebola patient out of our hospital. She had been admitted one night with a complaint of difficulty swallowing, denied every other symptom. I go into her room and she rolls over and she has the bright red zombie eyes of Ebola. And I take a step back, put on my gloves, start asking her questions. Motion to the nurse to go ahead and walk right out of the room. A few minutes later, she gets a call that her sister had died in the ETU. And so now she starts to have the emotional crisis and early signs of encephalopathy. And we just don't have any facility to be able to capably handle her or even contain her. So we don't have options. The family, her family has disappeared. We can't just kick her out into the street. So we call Dr. Scotland and I say, I beg you, please, do you have any beds open? And he says, I have one. Let me ask my boss. We'll hold it for you. So with a lot of bribing and threatening, an ambulance managed to come by and pick her up, which helped contain the exposure for our staff, as well as get her to the only place with any experience in treatment. She died 2 days later. I spoke to him again a few weeks later. He sounded committed and cheerful, because of course he was that, very truly. Despite the amazing strain, both physically and in being in a hot environment with amazing amounts of plastic over you, the emotional strain of watching people die horrible deaths, of watching 80 to 90% of a family be wiped out, and then watching the pain of the single survivor. But he was committed to what he decided to do because it needed to be done. He died 2 weeks later. Now, parents, I am not suggesting that your beautiful children run off into a dangerous crisis tomorrow. Instead, I want you to see Thomas Cotland and many others as the heroes they were, refusing to leave others alone in their misery, pain, and death. He saw a job that needed to be done. He saw a necessary environment for the skills he possessed. And because he was willing, he couldn't turn his back. His story is the inspiration for each of us when we face our own times of trouble. Don't worry, you don't need to go looking for it. It will find you. Whatever the crisis is, be it professional, financial, relational, or a great loss, I want you to remember these three things. First, you are human. Despite what we ask you to do, you are not God. You will make mistakes, no matter how hard you try. I will never forget Morris, a 16-year-old boy who I met 3 weeks after a horrible crushing injury to his leg. Through a series of mishaps, including equipment failure, lack of funds, no blood bank, and poor foresight on my part. He bled to death on my operating table. But that experience has taught me about anticipating obstacles, communicating with my team, recognizing the warning signs before imminent death. And I hope that experience will help me save many others. Understand your limitations forgive yourself. Learn from it and move on. Second, you are not alone. Look to your right. Look to your left. Look in front of you, look behind you. These are your friends, your colleagues, your families, your friends. Even 10 years in the future, you can call up one of these people. Not speaking to them for the last 10 years, having to look them up on Facebook or some yellow pages or ask everybody, hey, do you have so-and-so's number? You can ask them for advice and assistance. It is not humiliation to ask for help. It is inviting someone to work with you or through you to achieve a better goal. It is humbling and exhilarating to watch the forces come to your aid. Look up. God will carry you. He will send you when you need, when you most need it, and in your darkest moments. There is no burden that doesn't become lighter when you call for help. Finally, be brave. Be brave like Thomas Scotland when you decide to risk everything because someone needs you. Be brave in times of trouble. Be brave.
Dr. Hart, and to everyone that shared their stories this afternoon, thank you. All of us needed to hear that. I invite you to take your programs and turn to the page where this year's projects are listed. The specifics are the wish list of the alumni who are serving at these various locations around the globe. Some of the items listed may not seem that exciting or relevant, but when you are operating in Liberia, as Jillian Seaton does daily, where the water comes into the hospital during rainy season, or flies come in when it is hot and dry, paying for new windows isn't about aesthetics. It's rather about sanitation. And then there's Jonathan Thorpe from the class of 2012, who you saw in the first video. This past Wednesday, his post on social media was 36 hours of travel with one infant, a wonderful wife, an awesome mother-in-law, two cats, and 9 pieces of checked luggage. We all made it safe and sound to Nepal. I thank God for a wonderful trip. As a highly trained internist, Jonathan's ability to help his patients isn't about having a state-of-the-art intensive care unit, but rather about having basic equipment. I wonder how many of us sitting here would be willing to serve as Jillian or Jonathan or any of the others that we heard from today. Journalist Lisa Lang, during the School of Medicine centennial in 2009, shared a very brief but poignant story. It is as follows. On a street corner, I saw a cold, shivering girl in a thin dress with no hope of a decent meal. I got angry and said to God, "Why don't you do something? Why did you permit this?" God lovingly replied, "I certainly did do something about it. I made you." Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your many blessings, blessings that we so often take for granted. We ask you to be with each of the alumni and their families who take seriously your call to go into all the world and serve. Be with those of us who are here at home. May we do our part in sharing our resources to further the teaching and healing ministry of Jesus Christ to a hurting world. Amen. The offering will now be collected. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. He just returned from Malawi last week. On this mission project page, you will notice there are two categories that are not foreign countries. One is residency, international training rotation, and DMA fund. Understand that when students apply for medical schools, one of the attractions that they want to come to Loma Linda School of Medicine is because of our international training program. But this costs a lot of money for the students, for their travels and expenses. Through the generosity of our members and our friends, we have joined hands with the School of Medicine to help support this fund. And we also have the DMA program. Today we have checks to present to the four departments that have international rotation program. And please hold your applause until all five checks have been distributed. First, we would like to invite Dr. Carlos Garbaroglio, chairman of the Department of Surgery, to come. And we have a check for $5,000.
Thank you.
Next is the Department of OBGYN. And Dr. Sum Chung, are you here? $5,000 for the students' training expense. And for the Department of Pediatrics, Dr. Francis Chen. Dr. Francis Chen. And Dr. Roger Woodruff for the Family Medicine Department. With a DMA program, now graduates can go to serve mission fields. Simultaneously, they can amortize their student loans and their debts. This is a very popular program, and they need to have their funds replenished often. Again, with the generosity of our members and our donors, we're able to donate $10,000 towards this fund. Dr. Roger Hadley. Thank you. Now we would like to invite all missionaries who have served internationally to come up front, and our ushers have candles for each of you, and the song leaders will lead us in our theme song, So Send I You. And please come quickly so we can get you back to your class reunions. Some of you who have done this before, help those who are here for the first time.
Thank you.
I would like to thank all of you folks for coming to the Mission Vesper service. I would like to do the closing prayer, so let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your love for all of us. Your love has been reflected in all of these persons up here with the candles. They reflect like the light on the candle of your love by going out into the mission field. And there are those that are planning to and is in the mission field right now. We would like to ask you to bless them and their families and all those involved in helping them in the mission field. As we all conclude this busy weekend, please be with all of us. Help us reflect your light and your love to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.